In this video, we're going to be taking a look at the guidelines for planning a statistical study. And there is a list of these. If you look at the section in the book that discusses these, the list is a little bit different than what I'm going to discuss in this video. I'm going to include a step or two that's not actually listed in the book's discussion. So the book, I think, if I remember correctly, numbers the guidelines numbers 1 through 7, but I think there should actually be a step 0 when you are planning a statistical study, a thing that you do before you really do anything else. And that is to gather background and context. Until you have a really firm grasp of what it is that you're trying to study and the work that other people have already done in that field, it makes it really difficult to plan a statistical study that that maybe doesn't repeat some of the pitfalls of previous experiments or doesn't build on knowledge that's already out there. So I think that that piece is really key, gathering background and context. Then step 1 is to identify individuals or objects of interest. So this is the who are you going to include in your study. Step 2, we want to specify the variables. Specify the variables and how they will be measured. And you really want to be specific with this how they will be measured part. If you're going to be sending out a team of researchers that you're leading, but you're not going to be conducting all of the research yourself, one of the issues you can run into is if people aren't taking measurements consistently, on your research team, you can end up getting a lot of data back that you can't ultimately use for anything because it's not consistent data. So for example, if I were just to tell everybody in the class, you know, go out and collect a sample of 20 individuals and measure their head, right? Collect a head size measurement. Well, I might have people who do the measurements in inches. I might have people who do them in centimeters. I might have people who think that I want the height of the head from the top of the head to the chin. I might have people who think that I want the width of the head at the widest point. Some people might think I wanted circumference around the head. Some people might think I wanted an estimate of volume. I would get back all sorts of data and I wouldn't be able to analyze it because it's not consistent. So if you're sending out a team of people to do this data collection and to do this measurement, you need to be very specific with them. If instead what I said was go out, you know, get a random sample of 20 individuals and measure the circumference around their head at the widest point and provide that measurement in centimeters, I'm going to get back a lot more consistent data that I can actually do something with. Okay, so when you're specifying the variables, you want to be real specific about how they need to be measured. Step 3, determine if you will use the entire population. If not, choose an appropriate sampling method. Right, so sometimes it might be feasible to use population data if you have a small population that you're working with or one that it's easy to obtain the data that you need. If not, if you're going to be using a sample from the population, you need to use an appropriate sampling method from one of the ones that we've discussed. Step 4 is to determine a data collection plan. And address ethics and privacy if necessary. So for example, if you're going to be collecting medical data, if you've got a group of people and you're going to be collecting information about their medical history, privacy is a big thing. So usually if you're working for somewhere where you're going to be doing that kind of data collection, there are standard forms for informed consent and privacy and all of that kind of stuff that you would have participants in the study fill out. And usually the legal department would prepare those to make sure that they are binding legal documents. If you find yourself conducting a study and you know you're going to need to address ethics and privacy, definitely you'll want to check in with some kind of legal expert to make sure that the forms that you use to have people fill out are actually going to be appropriate for your purposes and that they're going to stand up as legal documents. So all of this is just pre-planning stuff, right, up to step four. Step five, we actually collect the data. Okay, so that's where we actually go out and we enact our data collection plan. We go and gather it. Step six, we analyze the data. Using appropriate statistical methods. Which we'll talk a lot about these, your different methodologies when analyzing data. We're going to talk about that for a good portion of the rest of the quarter. And then step seven, we note any concerns about the data. And we recommend remedies for further studies. Okay, so if when you were doing your experiment or your statistical study, something didn't go well, that's okay. That actually is very, very typical when you're doing research, is that not everything works exactly according to plan. And so you will note those things that didn't go well for your team and recommend what further studies could do to avoid those same kinds of pitfalls. This recommendation piece, this is a pretty standard piece in published research work. And that is why it's incredibly important when you're planning a study to do this step zero, to gather background and context. Because chances are someone went before you and did a similar study and can tell you what kinds of things to look out for when you're planning a study of your own. Okay, so those are the guidelines for planning a statistical study. In the next video, we're going to take a look at observational studies versus designed experiments.